It's even more exciting when you see your prayers walk around. Yes. The answer to your prayers.
Yes.
And I want to thank the Lord at BBM. Because it took the whole church, people that prayed and prayed and prayed, and God opened that door, and we got to see her on her birthday, and she got to come home. The Bible said, delight yourself in the Lord,
yes,
and give desires of,
yes,
your heart.
Yes.
And that's what we've been doing.
Amen.
Delighting ourselves in the Lord.
Yes.
Praising Him.
Yes.
Thanking Him.
Yes.
And that's one thing I just feel that God has just been really working in my life. And I can see that's where He wants us to go, is to start praising Him more and more and more every day.
Yes.
You know, and I was just looking up a few things. And if you look at synonyms for praise, it means to bless, to exalt, extol, glorify, magnify,
yes,
thank, and confess,
yes,
Jesus Christ is Lord. Think about just all that God has done for you.
Amen.
You know, you could stay all night and just keep thanking and thanking,
yes,
and thanking and thanking,
yes,
God.
Yep.
You know, because David and them, you know, the old saints, a lot of times they had it right, where they would just tarry with the Lord all night and just go and go and go and go and just, you know, it wasn't a time frame. You know, it was just like, I'm going to spend time and I'm going to tarry with the Lord because I know the Lord can make a difference.
Yes.
I know when I pray to God, He can turn those things around. One of the things that I love about the smartphone, there's some things that takes a little bit getting used to on when you first get them. But one thing I like is all the different translations you can just pull up.
Sure.
And sometimes that translation just kind of expands the verses. And,
yeah,
and one of the things that I really like is contemporary English version. And it was like sometimes, you know, people wonder, did God hear me? Do my tears make a difference?
Sure.
You know, I remember going through some things about a decade ago, and you're crying, and then this guy came on the TV and he was talking. He said, you know what? God keeps your tears in a bottle. That's how much important they are.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, wow, I never forgot that. That your tears make a difference. He understands your heart.
Yes.
He understands,
yes,
where you're at.
Yes.
And one thing, this contemporary English version, Psalm 56:8, you have kept record of my wandering. Have you stored my tears in your bottle and counted each of them?
Yes.
Is that a tender God right there?
Yes.
And you know, I think about it, I'm out driving a lot, you know, and I see sometimes when the mom, or it could be grandpa, walking their kids across the road, you know, and they'll grab their hand and they're, because they're caring for them.
Yeah.
And that's the picture I have with God.
Yeah.
You know, they used to sing that about God having a rocking chair. You know, and that's how we look at God.
Yeah.
You know, we was talking about that tonight at the supper table. That reason some people don't go to God because they think he's after them all the time.
Yeah.
He's after them.
Yeah.
You know, oh man, I don't know. You know, how many times they said that? I've had people say that, well, Tim, I'd go to church with you, but the church probably fall down.
Yeah.
Well, we'll take that chance.
Yeah.
But the church will fall down if you walk in there. I don't think it's going to fall down unless we got an earthquake or something.
Yeah.
Come on in, because that's where God wants you. Okay? He wants to draw you, you know, and come in and get to know Him. You know, you don't know. I don't know what God's like. Well, I tell you, let's find out what God's like. I tell you what, He's made a difference. He's made a difference. He counted your tears. And Psalm 56:9 in the same contemporary English version says, when I pray, Lord God, my enemies will retreat.
Yes.
Yeah.
I love that. They will retreat when you pray. Because the battle is the Lord. It's not ours. The battle is the Lord. It belongs to Him. He knows how to take care of all those situations. Because if God be for you, who can be against you? We on the right side. And it says, I love this. When I pray, Lord God, my enemies will retreat because I know for certain. I love that when people say certainty.
Yeah.
I love that word certain.
Yeah.
You know, it's not ambivalent, it's certain.
Right.
I love that. I know for certain that you are with me.
Yes.
How powerful is that?
Come on.
Come on, that's what we're talking about.
Yes.
Know for sure. That's what Paul said. I want to know Him.
Yeah.
Let me tell you something. You know, that makes all the difference in the world. When you have an experience, when you have that knowledge, that's why they were so, like, when it came to Peter and the disciples, you know, they couldn't understand. Because they didn't have all the learning what we would think about. But they knew they'd been with them. Why? Because they sounded like them.
Yeah.
They acted like them.
Yeah.
They went out. There was something different about them.
Yeah,
they was unlearned. They didn't have all teaching. But you know what? That's what happens when Jesus is in your life.
Amen.
You think differently.
That's right.
You know, I'm in a profession that I'm telling you, you have to be patient. Think about that. Because I know I said this before, but you talk about driver's ed, and then you multiply that by a semi. Okay? Let me tell you. But I think it's a great, I believe God put me there. But you know what? It teaches you to be patient. Teaches you to take time. And one thing God wants us to never, ever forget is where he brought us from.
That's right. Yeah. That's right.
Never forget that you were new. Mm-hmm. Never forget when you first became a Christian. You know, the Bible says all things become new, but it doesn't say become new instantly.
Right.
It doesn't say that. Right. It's a process.
Yeah.
And one thing I love about God, you know, if you fall down, he's going to be with you. Come on, let's get up and go again. Okay? We're not done yet. Man, I'll tell you what. I know I said this before, but man, if God gave up on us like we do sometime, our friends, man, we'd all be gone. You know? If we make one mistake, some people, they ain't going to have nothing to do with it. You know, I'm a human being. We're going to make mistakes. Okay? But you know what? God looks at it and says, you know what? You're my child, and I'm going to still bear with you. I'm going to still love you. Let's sit down and talk about this. That's what he said in Isaiah. Let's reason together. Let's come down and talk. What's going on? Why are you making this mistake? It's not a problem. I never did figure it was a problem making a mistake as long as you learn from it. You know, we saw it. We was going home today, and we stopped at Grand and 14th. And right where Quick Trip's at, and a car went left on 15th, which is a one-way street going north. Two of them in a row, one followed the other down there. Now, I'm thinking, man, I'm thinking, we got a serious mistake because it's busy that time, you know? And they just went, and all the cars was honking, and it go through. Now, what are we supposed to do to people like that? Yeah, they made a mistake, and they got off the road, but you know what? They're not evil people. Okay, God still loves them. God still loves us when he makes a mistake. God still loves us with a sin. You know what? You know what? When Jesus died, he died for that sin nation. You know, people put sin in categories.
Yeah.
And that's the wrong thing to do, because they'll put sin in categories. Well, you know, we kind of put sin. We got this dirty dog sinner over here. Oh, they're a real bad sinner. What did Jesus die for? He died, you know, they say lies, you know, white lies. And I'm going to tell a little white lie. Well, I tell you what, the Bible, I don't see nowhere in the Bible where it says white lie, blue lie, green lie. Tell me, if somebody can show me different, I've never seen that. A lie is a lie.
Right.
Jesus wanted to get that heart, that sin nature out so they can fill up with him so he can do something different. David said, I hid the word in my heart so I might not sin against it. So when you come back in that tent, no, I won't do that.
Right.
You know why? Because I serve a holy God.
Yeah.
And we serve a holy God, and that means we need to act holy. And we need to act holy 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. He don't give us a break. Well, I'll be good 23 hours a day, but one day I got to act up. 1 hour of the day. No, we're supposed to be holy and right all day long. And we're supposed to take that time to praise him, because you know what? We are fearfully, wonderfully made.
Amen.
And you ever notice this? You ever notice this? That the one thing about it, we was created in God's image.
Yes. Right.
You ever notice that?
Yes.
Because we created God's image. I got to thinking about that one day. Why? The most of us are going to have two arms, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's why most of us are going to have two arms, right? That way you can hug.
Yeah.
You know? You ever gave God a hug? You know, you think about reaching out and giving a hug and say, hey, you know, I love you, God. I love you and I appreciate you. And Roberta said, you know, last week we could talk about, you know, we should listen more than we talk.
Yeah.
It's amazing what we can learn. Because he said, well, Tim, God don't talk to me. He said, man, what are you talking about? He talks to me every day. What do you think this is?
Yeah.
That's his word. And he's teaching right here. Is that true? That's his word of God. He talks to you every day. Some people don't want to listen. Okay, and what God, I really feel, if we would spend that time on our knees and praising God, and then listen to what God has to say, I'm telling you, it's better to pray before the fact than after the fact. You know, so many times we just ask God, should I do this or not do that?
Right.
You know, but see, we don't want, because he might say, you shouldn't do that. And we already got in mind we want to do that.
Yeah.
But God said, hey, you know what, I'm saving you from a lot of heartache. You know, it's like choosing a mate, you know? Like sometimes we wait till our heart gets wrapped up and then, God, should I be with this person? Well, now your heart's all wrapped up. You're not going to listen to them. I went out to Philadelphia and my daughter, she didn't know I was coming. She knew I was coming, but the preacher didn't. And I was singing at the time. And the preacher was talking about this very issue. He said, you know, why don't people ask God to show that person their heart. You know, ask God to say, is this the person I should be? Because he can look into the heart, because God looks on the heart. I thought, wow, how simple is that? Wouldn't that cause a lot of heartaches not to happen if you just ask God? And that's what I feel he wants us to do. I'm going to share this one scripture here. And it says, I love this. It's Psalms 139, and it's amplified. And I just love this, because one thing about God is that, you know, he's always working. He is always working. And he starts, he said, I will confess. He said, I praise you, for you are fearfully and wonderful, for the awful wonder of my birth. Wonderful are your works, and that my inner self knows right well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being formed in secret, and intricately and curiously wrought as if embroidered with various colors in the depths of the earth and a region of darkness and mystery. Your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book, all the days of my life were written before ever they took shape, even as yet there was none of them. How precious, oh, folks, how precious and weighty also are your thoughts to me, O God. How vast is the sum of them. If I could count them, they would be more numbered than they said. When I woke, could I count to the end, I would still be with you. Isn't that something? I will still be with you. Yeah. Just imagine, you know, there's going to be a day we'll go to heaven, we'll always be with God.
Yeah.
We'll never be separated from God.
Right.
And just think about that. The one who created, the one who made you, the one who understands you. And, you know, I always said, like, go to heaven. I tell you right, it's going to be a noisy place because it's going to be filled with praise.
Yeah.
We're going to be praising God. Well, we ought to start down here and start praising God and keep going to heaven and praise. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, hallelujah tonight. Oh, I just want to just praise God tonight. You know, and just thank him so much for being so good.
Yes.
You know, that's why I feel it just direction is just to continue to praise God, lift him up every day.
Yes.
And we're going to open this service up. Anybody would like to share a prayer request or praise what God has done?
A few things. You know, I'm so grateful for all the good things that God's doing. A lot of great and wonderful things are happening, not only for me and my friend, but also for my family overall. I said here before my mother and my sister came that something was going to happen when they were here. And I believe there's a breakthrough happening right now in my sister's life.
Yeah. Hallelujah.
There's some things that God is removing.
Hallelujah.
In her life that shouldn't be there.
Hallelujah.
He's opening some doors for her as well, for some things that she's been wanting for a while. And for my other sister too, also, you know, it's really good to see how he's working on my brother's life for his family. My brother called me earlier today and he said, you know, I want you to stand with me in agreement and pray that my wife finds the job that God wants her to have.
Amen.
She's been going to a few interviews, and every time she goes to the next interview, they tell her that the job that they're interviewing her for is actually better than the one she interviewed previously.
Yeah.
So it kind of keeps going out.
Yeah.
Right.
No, this is actually better than the one you did before, so we're going to interview you for this one. So my brother, you know, he would like for us to stand in agreement with him that God's going to reveal to them which is the one that they should have, which is the best for them.
Amen.
And the one last thing, I was asked to lift up this gentleman. I believe his name is Justin. You know, he's a man after God's heart, and he's very proud of his family, but recently his wife left him for another woman. So just that God restores that family and brings them back together again. Because he's very destroyed by this situation.
Yeah. Definitely pray. God's able. God is able. You know, we serve a mighty God. And he don't like to see families torn apart. You know, he don't like to see that brokenness in there. You know, but God can still heal a broken heart. Hallelujah. He's still able. Someone else will praise God for what he's done.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
There's no condemnation. God loves me like I am, because I am the righteousness of God in Christ.
see more.
Yeah,
it got a little higher, and you see a little more.
Yeah.
And you see those things. And that's what God does. I mean, we go through peaks and valleys, but we learn a lot in the valleys too.
Sure.
You know, we learn, because I'm telling you, in the valleys, you know, some person said, you know, well, Tim, I come to the end of my rope. You know, I always tell them the same thing. You know, you come to the end, I said, that's good.
Yeah.
And they always look at your eyes, get about that big. But Jesus said he's the beginning and the end.
Yes.
So you come right up against him.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
You know, sometimes you got to get that far down. The only way you can't look is up.
Yeah.
That's it. That's it. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Yes.
Lift up Suzanne. She's with her dad. Had his hip surgery today. The surgery went well. Just pray for total healing. She mentioned something about he has to walk up some stairs to mm-hmm. get up to his bedroom and stuff like that. So we're praying for provision, the total healing, and the transition for him and Suzanne and the family there. Just glorify the Lord. Just glorify
Hallelujah.
The Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah. We're going to do that. God is good. God is good. Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yes.
We lift you up tonight. Yes. Because you are God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. There's none like you. There's none like you. The everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. There is none like you. Hallelujah. Our Lord and our Savior. Jesus Christ, we pray. We pray. Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Some of you may remember Shaylee, my granddaughter. Hallelujah. And her friend Kylie. She's standing with us. And Jody Ann. She's back. You know what? Between her and Jason today, I saw some preaching on Facebook today. It was, oh man, look out. They were burning stuff up, man. It was awesome. I love it. I love it. It's just the anointing just starts flowing on it, the calling and the preaching and speaking the truth and just taking it on down. I didn't see the downside of what was coming against you, but all I saw was the forefront and just the pushing back way back. And that's all I saw that. So I appreciate the word. I appreciate the truth. I appreciate the freedom. Thank you, Tammy. I appreciate it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. So, as these two young ladies help me pray downstairs about youth ministry. They need the confidence and the insurance, the assurance of the Lord leading young hearts. And the other thing was, how's Sally doing?
She's doing better.
Okay, so they've been major concerns on my heart. So just pray for us. We're going to talk about things downstairs and just pray over things. And we'll just praise him and worship him.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
We will
dance for your glory. We will dance, we will dance for your glory. We will dance for your glory, Lord. We will lift up a shout. We will lift up a shout to adore you. Every sound that we make, it is for you. Greatest day in history, death is beaten, you have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. Empty cross, the empty grave, life eternal, you have won the day. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. Greatest day, greatest day in history. I like that. That sounds good. Come on, sing it out. Forever I am trained. Yes, Lord, when I stand in that place. Happy day, happy day, I'll never be the same. Oh, happy day, happy day, you washed my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day, I'll never be the same. Praise. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Ladies are sounding awesome, aren't they? Glory to God. Hallelujah.
Angels gather around you. Presence. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for every good and every perfect gift comes from you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your goodness and your mercy. Thank you, Jesus, for saving us. for keeping us, blessing us, prospering us. Thank you, Lord, for being our source. Thank you, Lord, for never turning your back on us, even when we've turned away from you. You're faithful, Lord. Your faithfulness, Lord, is eternal and unchanging, even as you. We just bless you tonight, Lord. Thank you for the privilege of knowing you. Thank you, Lord, for speaking to our... Thank you for drawing us by your Spirit, Lord, that we could even respond and say yes to your goodness and your grace. Thank you, Jesus. We just bless you tonight. And everybody said, in Jesus' name. Jesus. Praise the Lord. God bless you. You may be seated. Thank you so much, worship team. And thank you, ladies. You two young gals did a great job. Praise the Lord. And you older gals did pretty good too. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. The guys I'm not even going to talk about tonight. Hallelujah. But God bless all of you for being here. Thank you all. We appreciate you coming out tonight. Praise the Lord. And we'll get right into this so that I don't keep you late, but I want to talk to you about how the Lord sees us, how he describes us. And I appreciate the talking about Jody and Jason and their sharing the Word of God, and Tobin and Jody talking about witnessing. But all of us are doing this all the time, whether we realize it or not. We are a manifestation, if you will, of God's reality in this earth. And so, you know, people that know us to be Christians especially, they do watch, they do listen, they do pay attention to what's different about us, you know. And sometimes that can be kind of, I don't know what the exact word would be, but I don't want to use the wrong word, so I may just pass by it. But sometimes it can be kind of daunting, you know, when you're having a rough time and you know that people expect certain things of you and you want to do the right thing. You know, you want to be what God has defined you as. So sometimes it can be a little bit nerve-wracking, maybe I should say. But I want us to relax, okay? Because we are living epistles. We are what God says we are. And we can have an influence in people's lives, no matter how screwed up our own lives are sometimes. You know what I'm saying? And so sometimes we can have the greatest impact when we're struggling with things because we respond to it differently. You know, we just don't throw up our hands and go for the 9mm, you know, or the 10 cc's, whatever, praise the Lord. But we deal with it, hallelujah, with the help of Jesus. So let's move right into this before I completely lose my train of thought. 2 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 15. Hallelujah. I just feel the love of God here tonight. Amen. It's just so good. You know, I know there's not a lot of us here, but that's okay. God's here, and that makes us a majority, amen, in any situation, in any circumstance. So praise the Lord. Hallelujah. 2 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 15. We are unto God a sweet savor of Christ in them that are saved and in them that perish. Okay, let's look at it again. We are unto God a sweet savor. Good smell. Amen. The smell of Christ, the aroma of Christ in them that are saved and in them that perish. All right, now chapter 3 and verse 3. Same book. For as much as ye are manifestly declared to be the epistle of Christ, ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not in tables of stone, but in fleshly tables of the heart. Praise the Lord. All right, same book, chapter 5, verse 20. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ. As though God did beseech you by us, we pray you in Christ's stead, be ye reconciled to God. Amen? Praise the Lord. So right here in just three chapters of 2 Corinthians, Paul's writing to the Corinthian church, amen, and he describes us, the church, amen, as the pleasing aroma of Christ among those who are being saved and those who are perishing. Amen? And then he says, we are a letter from Christ, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not in the law, not in legalism, but in the tablets of human hearts. You know, the law is inflexible. It's just rigid, and it's good, it's holy, if it's used for what it's supposed to be used for. But there's no mercy in the law. The law is just what it is. We have a witness, an ability to be a written epistle, a book of the Bible, so to speak, for God. I believe he's writing another book of Acts, or a final chapter, amen, if you will, in our lives. So we are this epistle, amen, that isn't rigid and stern and inflexible, but it's written in our hearts. We have the capacity to love and to be merciful and to extend grace to people the same way God does, and that's the way he wants us to be, amen. And then he says, we are Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. Amen? So we really need to know how God feels about this if we're going to be able to exactly express God to people, to other people. Amen?
Amen?
So all of these metaphors are saying we are the representatives and the reflection of God's amazing grace in this world today.
Amen?
Amen? That's what we are. That's who we are, whether we like it or not, whether we want to be a participant or don't want to be. You just are if you're born again. Praise the Lord. So we have to let God's grace pour through us, amen, so people can experience God and this amazing grace, amen. They got to experience it somewhere, and it needs to be through people like us, amen, that are born again. All right, let's look at this, Roberto. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 10. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourself. It's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. So the basic question, really, of every religion, now, I'm not going to get into how you get saved. I think everybody's aware how you get saved. You trust in the finished work of the cross. You believe in Jesus, in his death, burial, and resurrection. Amen. And it's a free gift. It's just by grace. All we do is believe. We just have to operate by faith, actually the faith of Christ. But we respond to this free gift. But the basic question in every religion is what is required to get in. This is what makes Christianity different from every religion, because it really is about a relationship.
Yes.
You know, normally you would think, okay, to be a part of a religion, you got to stop certain things, and you got to start doing other things, right?
Yeah.
Stop doing this and start doing this. Clean up, you know, get your act together, praise the Lord. Promise to be something different than what you have been.
Right.
I mean, that's generally what we think of. In other words, you have to work for it, praise the Lord, and you're then judged on your performance. That's not true in Christianity. We are given a free gift. Because God first loved us, then we love in response. What God wants to do is fill us so full of his grace, of his love, that we do good works, not because we're doing good works in order to get God's favor or to get saved or to stay saved, but just simply because it's what we are, it's what we do, it's our nature to be more like Christ.
Yes.
And that's not about, you know, perfect living. It's about an expression of God, the love of God, the goodness of God, the mercy of God, the forgiveness of God, all the things that we've heard about from Tim all the way through every testimony and everything that's been said here this evening. Amen? So it's amazing, really, what Christianity and how Christianity actually functions. The entrance requirements for Christianity are, come as you are. Just come. Just come. We don't care about anything else. Amen. Just come. Amen. No lifestyle overhaul is required. Amen. A lifestyle change will take place, but it isn't something that's required of you in order to be a part of it. Amen. You just come and let the Holy Spirit deal with us. Let the Holy Spirit do what only the Holy Spirit can do. Amen. Hallelujah. You say, well, Nathan, how can it be that simple? Because your salvation is not based on anything that you have done or on anything you promised to do in the future.
That's right.
Yep. Your lost condition wasn't based on anything you did.
No.
Just based on who you were. Your birth made you lost. Amen? So you had to be born again in order to be saved. You didn't do anything to get lost other than get born. Likewise, it'd be unfair of God to do it differently, and we know that He's fair. So God says He's just. And so God says is okay. Then you just got to be born again.
Yeah. Amen.
It won't be what you do; it's about your position. It's about who you are.
Right.
Praise the Lord. So you're born again. Amen. Now, there's nothing you can do to make God love you more.
No.
No matter how much you do, no matter how many good things you do, God's not going to feel any differently about you. And likewise, you can't make God love you any less.
Right.
No matter how nasty you get, no matter how stupid you act, God's feelings for you do not change.
Right.
You know, God loves you. So what about all the commandments? What about all these, the shall nots? Well, first of all, God doesn't require adherence to any commandments as a prerequisite for your salvation. Not under the new covenant.
Right.
The commandments have all been fulfilled by Jesus.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Remember, God rescued Israel from their bondage in Egypt before there was any Ten Commandments, before there was any law whatsoever.
Yep.
He just did it because He chose to save them. He loved them. Amen. Let's look at this in Matthew chapter 22, verse 35 through 40. So we're saved, okay? We'll just grant that. So we're saved, right? So Jesus is talking to this young Jewish lawyer, one of them, which was a lawyer, asking him a question, tempting him, and saying, Master, which is the great commandment in the law? Then one of the, okay, keep going. And Jesus said unto him, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind, and this is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it, Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Praise the Lord. So it's so simple. If somebody is looking for what it takes to be a Christian, to live a Christian life, that's it. It's that simple. It's not complicated.
No, it's not.
Praise the Lord. Love God. Love others.
Yeah.
It's good. I mean, God is, He's not going to make this complicated. We've made it complicated.
Yes.
God just says, love me, love others.
Yeah.
That'll work. That'll get it. That'll make it happen. Amen. Humans, though, because of the, especially in this culture, but I think it's true of all humans, we want to achieve. You know, we want to win. We want to be the best at whatever it is we're doing.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
But the frustrating thing about that is not everybody can be the best
at
everything, right?
Right.
So there's a built-in opportunity here for failure.
Right.
Amen? Failures happen.
Yeah.
Everybody experiences failure. But that doesn't make you a failure. Just like sinning doesn't make you a sinner if you're born again. With me?
Yes.
Amen? Just like doing good works when you're unsaved doesn't make you saved.
Right.
Praise the Lord. So failing at things does not make you a failure as far as God's concerned. In fact, that's the very kind of men and women that God's looking for.
Yes.
Amen. That makes me feel really good because I got a chance, amen,
yeah.
Hallelujah, because I've been known to fail, but God never fails.
Right.
He never fails me. Even though I fail God, I fail other people. But God doesn't. God loves an underdog. How many of you like to root for the underdog? You know, when there's a boxing match or a fight, a ball game or whatever. You know, if I don't know the teams, if they're not Iowa or Iowa State, I'm always rooting for the one that's supposed to lose. I just want somebody to upset somebody. I want to see the guy that wasn't supposed to win score a knockout, you know, and I just like to see it and go, wow, that's great. This guy just didn't think he had a chance. Nobody else thought he had a chance. And all of a sudden, they're raising his hand in the middle of the ring, or they're getting the trophy or whatever it is. It's just, to me, I love it. Well, God's word is full of underdogs. And what we would probably even call failures, but underdogs for sure. Just think about Noah. Now here's a guy who's the laughingstock of the whole area wherever people know about Noah.
Yeah.
He's out here building an ark. Yeah. It's never rained before.
Yeah.
It's never rained on earth. There's this vaporous ability for dew and so forth to moisture, you know, to saturate the earth so the plants and everything can grow. But there's never been any rainfall. So he's out here building this huge boat in a landlocked area. There's no water there. He's just building a boat in the desert. Now you got to figure people are thinking, this guy, we knew he was strange, you know, but he's just out of his mind. And the whole family's flipped out. They're all working on this boat. So he's like the laughingstock of his world. Because he's building something that nobody could figure out in order to save his family before something that nobody had ever seen.
Exactly.
Praise the Lord. Yeah. And he's telling them this thing that they've never seen, that they don't understand, is going to destroy the world.
Yeah.
And yet, that's exactly what he did.
Uh-huh.
And then there's Abraham and Sarah. They're well into their 80s, no kids, no children. Amen. In a culture that places extremely high value on large families.
Right.
Amen. And here they are with nothing. And against all odds, God gave them a son. And he made Abraham the father of a great nation. Now, Abraham means that, the father of a multitude. Now, imagine every time Abraham introduced himself to anybody for years.
Sure.
Hi, I'm Abraham. Hi, I'm the father of a multitude. Oh, yeah, how many kids you got? Well, actually, we don't have any children, but how old are you?
Yeah.
86, but, you know, I'm not dead.
Yeah.
You know, people had to be thinking, come on, man, this is an idiot. I mean, this guy's crazy, right? Then Jacob, here's an underdog. This guy's he's a deceiver. Jacob, actually, the name means crooked.
Yeah.
And, you know, to prove his name, he cheats his brother out of his birthright.
Yeah.
He is a cheat. He is a deceiver. No matter how you cut it. Amen? But he becomes the father of 12 sons who became the patriarchs of the 12 tribes of Israel.
Yeah.
Amen? Then there's Joseph, another underdog. Joseph, because of his jealous brothers, which was partly his own fault, because he did kind of flaunt the coat of many colors and the fact that he was daddy's favorite. And, you know, so the brothers, they sell him off into slavery. Now, that's not bad enough. He gets into slavery, and then he's falsely accused of another crime, and he's thrown into prison. On top of being a slave, now he's in prison. But eventually, the people of Israel and Egypt, by the way, are delivered from a great famine because of this guy. Then there's Moses. Moses, he kills a guy for I guess because he wanted to show his affiliation with the Jews, but it's still murder. So he kills a guy, and then he flees to Midian, off into the middle of nowhere in the desert. A murderer who ran away from the crime, and God restores him and uses him to lead the people of Israel out of Egypt. Rahab, it's a prostitute. But she hides two spies that were on a mission for God, keeps the enemy from being able to get to him. And this is so cool. God loves this whore so much that he wants to be born through her genealogy. He puts her in his own genealogy. The one everybody else would have shunned. And if you look at the genealogy, God came in the flesh through that woman, through her genealogy, through the marriage that she had, her children, and so forth. Amen? That's cool. If that isn't God saying, look, I'm with you. It's okay. You're all right for me. Amen?
Yes.
Now, how about David? Here's a guy who was so nothing that when it came time for the prophet of God to come and anoint a king, his dad didn't even bother calling him from the field. His own father didn't even think, there's no point in calling him in. There's no way they're going to call it. They're going to use him. It's got to be one of these older boys. They're smarter. They're bigger. They're stronger. They look more like a king. So he doesn't even bother to call him. And when the prophet gets through going through all of them, God keeps saying, nope, 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 nope. He finally says, have you got any more kids? Well, yeah, he said, I've got that boy that I used to keep the sheep. Well, bring him here. Yeah. Amen. This nobody, this young man, this no military experience, because when he goes to fight Goliath, his brothers are in the military. But David's not. So he doesn't have any military experience. But God enables him to defeat Goliath and to become king.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Then there's Mary and Elizabeth. Am I boring you yet? Both of them have a problem. Mary is this young virgin who has to endure the gossip, the degradation of others because of this unexplainable pregnancy. Elizabeth was barren. That was her cousin. She was older and had never had any children, couldn't have children. And then she gives birth to a prophet who announces the coming of Mary's child, Jesus, the Messiah.
Yeah.
These are underdogs.
Yeah.
These are people nobody would have expected God to do anything with, and God chooses to do everything with them. Then there's the 12 apostles. These guys, as Tim said earlier, they were not wise men. They were not super intelligent people. They were from a lower level of society. They weren't well educated. There was no way that they could be a part of the prestigious religious times that they lived in. In other words, they could have never been a rabbi. They could have never been a priest. They could have never been, looked up to in terms of their relationship or their religious experiences. Amen? And yet, Jesus called them to something greater. And by Jesus, they actually changed the entire world.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. How about Paul? Here is, you talk about radical Islam. This was radical Judaism. They were killing people for changing religions. Paul was a persecutor, a religious fanatic. And God says, I believe I can use you. Now, we know he was a participant at least in one death, which was Peter, and the scripture says that he was imprisoning, killing, and torturing Christians. Now, we'd think, get him. Get him, God. And God says, I got him. He's going to write 2/3 of the New Testament, and he's going to be my witness to the Gentiles, to the non-believers. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Failure hurts, but you can't let it get you down. Failure puts you in a place where God can use you. Amen.
Yes.
Amazingly, God uses your failures as part of his plan for you to be successful.
Yes.
Amen. Let's look at Romans 5 and verse 18. Praise the Lord. Amen. Therefore, as by the offense of one, judgment came upon all men to condemnation, even so by the righteousness of one, the free gift came upon all men unto justification of life. So Adam and Eve failed. Everybody says, yeah, we know that. Adam and Eve failed, but God used their disaster to introduce his plan of salvation through Jesus Christ. And it was a plan that had been in God before the foundation of the world, before Adam and Eve were ever even created. So their failure actually brings about the revelation of God's plan for everybody to be saved. Praise the Lord. Amen. Exodus chapter 3, verse 10. Come now, therefore, and I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. This we were just talking about Moses a minute ago, a murderer. Yep. Amen? And God uses him, this murderer, to lead the Jews out of bondage, Amen, to freedom, into relationship with God. Praise the Lord. Yep. We have a tendency to look at these people with 2020 hindsight. But had you lived in that time and seen their life, you would have probably said, "Whoa, God's not going to use them. He can't use them. They're failures. They're screw-ups. They're just trouble." Amen? All right, Luke chapter 1, verses 31 through 33. This is talking about David. Amen. Behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son and shall call his name Jesus. He shall be great and shall be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father, David. And he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. So we've got Jesus saying his father or his genealogically, his ancestor is David, a murderer, an adulterer, he rebelled against God. God had to punish Israel for his numbering the people after God told him not to. There's several other things that was going on there in David's life. David was far from anything perfect. He was a failure in many, many ways. Family was totally dysfunctional. And yet, God said, this is a man after my own heart. God, I'm telling you, to not love this God, you have to just be intentionally ignorant or have set under so much garbage and untruths about God. God is love. And his whole book, this whole revelation of him, amen, is telling us that. He loves us. He loves us in all of our humanity, in all of our failures. He loves us. Yes. Amen? He wants us to love him. Yes. He wants us to accept his love and his goodness. 1 Kings chapter 19 and verse 4. He himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a juniper tree. He requested for himself that he might die. And said, it's enough now. Oh, Lord, take away my life, for I am not better than my fathers. You can go to verse 7 now, same chapter. This is Elijah. Anybody ever been there? Yeah. You know, nothing's working. Everything's going to pieces. Lord, just take me. Just get me out of here. I'm just sick of the whole thing. Depressed, you know, struggling with everything. And the angel of the Lord came again the second time and touched him and said, arise and eat, because the journey is too great for thee. Verse 12. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord wasn't in the fire. And after the fire, still small voice. Praise the Lord. Amen. I've been there where I just felt like, it's enough, Lord. I just don't want to go anymore. Just feeling sorry for yourself, you know, because you're going through stuff. But still, it happens. Yeah. Humans, it just gets to be like, God, is it ever going to end, you know? But notice, in the midst of this depression, God is feeding him. Somehow God is ministering to him. And ultimately, he's struggling to hear the voice of God. And again, like Tim was saying, sometimes we just need to shut up. Because all the time we're complaining, God's trying to talk. Yeah. and we're not listening because we're too tied up with our own thoughts and our own feelings. But after all of the rigmarole comes a still small voice. I'm with you. I'll never leave you. It's going to be all right. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. This self-centered, self-pitying, depressed man, God strengthens. God cares for him. God speaks to him. Praise the Lord. All right, John chapter 21, verse 15 through 17. John 21, 15 through 17. Last night I was laying in bed looking up at the stars, and I thought to myself, where's the ceiling? So when they had dined, geez, I just don't want to break the mood here. So when they had dined, Jesus saith to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? He saith unto him, yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. And he saith unto him, feed my lambs. And he saith to him again the second time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? And he saith unto him, yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. And he saith unto him, feed my sheep. He saith unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved because he said unto him the third time. Remember, Peter had denied him three times. Lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. And Jesus saith unto him, feed my sheep. So Peter is proof that our failings are not fatal. That God still will use you as a witness.
Yes.
With all of your issues. God still wants to use you.
Yes.
You see the pattern here?
Yeah.
Every person God uses has a history of failure.
Yes.
Everybody.
Yes.
God uses failure to accomplish his purpose. He doesn't cause the failure, but he turns the failure into success.
Right.
Let's wrap it up here with a couple scriptures. Romans chapter 8, verse 28. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. Now, when you're in the all things, usually it doesn't seem like it. But the beauty of God is all things work together for our good because we're called according to his purpose. He has a purpose and a plan. Whether we understand it or not, he has one. And he's going to use our lives, even our failures and everything else about it, he's going to use it to bring about his purpose and bring good to us. That's a good God. That is a good God. Amen. All right, last scripture, 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9. 2 Corinthians 12 and 9. Don't let the devil tell you, and he does it to all of us, don't let him tell you, well, you know, you're not ever going to be able to do anything for God. You're just, you know, you just need to get in the back and just stay out of the way and let somebody else do it. That is malarkey. God wants to use your unique life in a way that only God can do, and he'll change other people's lives because of you, because of your uniqueness.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. He said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. So God chooses what we call failures because when we fail, we know we're weak. And when we're weak, like the old song goes, he is strong. Praise the Lord. Whenever we can come to the end of ourselves, we'll find God right there, waiting to move, waiting to do what only God can do. Amen? Hallelujah. There is nothing too big for God. God gets such pleasure out of taking what the culture and what the world says is nothing and bringing something powerful and great out of it. Jesus was a man of no reputation. He was a carpenter's kid. Amen? And look what God did. That was God. That was God's choice of how to come into this world. You know, he would have been harassed all of his young life for being a illegitimate child.
Yeah.
You know they would have.
Yeah.
This is a culture that had, you know, this really strict morality stuff.
Yes.
Along with his mother being you know, whispered about, I'm sure, every place you went? Jesus was. But look, what the world called a failure. When he hung on the cross, they said, well, that's the end of that. No, no. No, that was just the beginning. That was just the beginning. And every one of us are getting the advantage, amen, of that very thing. We need to remind ourselves. We look at these patriarchs, these great individuals in the Bible, and we think, oh, man, if I could just be like them. Well, you are. You know, you just are. If you would just read the whole story, you'd find out, yeah, just like me. Failures. Weak people that God raises up and does something supernatural and spectacular with.
Ever since you started talking about all the failures and what they did, this overwhelming urge to scream, well, you see what he does with me?
Yes, that's right. Give the Lord a hand. Praise the Lord. Amen. That's exactly what the way we need to feel. Yes. Lord, what? I can't wait to see what you're going to do with me.
Yes.
Amen. I'm perfect tool here, you know.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Amen. You can't screw up any more than I have. Well, maybe you can, but you have to really work at it. Praise the Lord. And God's hand, he can handle it. He can handle it all.
Yes.
And not only can he handle it, He'll spit in the eye of the devil while he does it.
Yes.
Amen. Yes. Here he's saying, nah, you're never going to amount to anything. Look at your life. You're such a mess. You're so screwed up. And it's like the Lord just says, watch this.
Yeah.
Yeah. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Expect something spectacular for your life. Expect something supernatural because it's going to happen. Amen.
Yes.
Where two or more can agree. God's word has already been released here. All he needs is you to agree with it.
Yes.
You don't need a whole million people. You don't need even three or four people. Three be good, but all you need, God has said it. If you'll return that word back to him out of your mouth,
yes.
I am the righteousness of God in Christ. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Amen.
Yes.
And then God in you become a force that is unstoppable.
Yes.
Amen. Every one of these people found it out, and it's high time we did.
Yes.
God's wanting to write that final chapter.
Exactly.
Amen. Yes. The book of Acts. You know, like the, what do we used to call it, the Reader's Digest, you know, the condensed version.
Yeah.
He's about to amplify it. Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
And we get to participate. Yeah. Give the Lord a hand clap. Praise the Lord. Amen, amen. God bless you. In Christ, you're always a winner.
Yes.
No matter what.
That's right.
Go in that power and that reality, amen, and watch God move this world on your behalf.
Yeah.
Amen. He'll do it. That's what he wants to do. In Jesus' name. Praise God.
Amen.
You're dismissed in his name. Hallelujah.
Amen.